So the good point is that we're not going to discuss much of data science here. It's when I say that it is doing data science on cloud, is it's the type of jobs or the type of task we are trying to run in a data science, how we manage that. And the last two talks are actually going to be the like the building blocks for this talk, because we are going to talk about Docker, we are going to talk about Kubernetes, and we are going to talk about cross-region Kubernetes to reduce the latency. And we are going to talk about cross-cloud vendor Kubernetes. Right? So one cluster in AWS, one cluster in Google Cloud, the other can be in Azure. Okay, so let's see how it goes. So a bit about me, I have around 8.5 years experience and right now working with Schlumberger. Before this, I was with the real-time analytics team of Snapdeal, and where we are performing a lot of how many users are online at a particular point of time, what is the user behavior and all. I had good experience on working with ad serving domain. I mean, working in ad serving domain as well, formatting and all, where multiple petabytes of data was something which I handled as a simple Spark Hadoop developer. Okay, so let's see. This is going to be the agenda of the talk. We are going to define the importance of running data science in cloud in a new way. Right? It's not that old way in the bookish thing which we are going to discuss about. We are going to define the what is machine learning as a service. Everybody is providing that. We will look into that. And by using machine learning as a service, what are the couple of basic issues which your vendor solves, right? And we are going to pick those issues, and we are going to talk about a generic infrastructure which takes care of those two issues, and it gives you a cloud vendor independent infrastructure, right? So if you can handle those like 3-4 issues, whatever will come up, we'll see. If you can resolve that in a generic way on bare metal machines, I mean containers running on bare metal machines, I think we are done, right? We can just take the setup and you can move to any other cloud. So we will look into that, and finally we'll talk about Kubernetes Federation, which we had started using it. So as well as a new term which is in the market these days, which is Ubernetes. We'll see what it is. And with these three major subsections, I have a demo, and the demo is recorded. You will see that I did that at 4 or 3 or 4 in the morning. But then that is just for saving the time, because with so many components working together, it can actually be a flop if you intend to show a big demo. So I will be showing the videos for that, but mind you, the infrastructure is up and running. So anybody who wants to look into the infrastructure, whatever I'm showing, he can get in touch with me outside or wherever you can. Okay. So let's start. So the requirement is unpredictable need of infrastructure these days, right? The days are gone when we talk about scalability and I have an application which is right now running on 4 nodes, and whenever there is a requirement, I will scale to 5. I will scale up by 5 nodes, right? Those days are gone. The thing is that if your traffic has increased, if the requirement has increased, your infrastructure should have the capability of scaling up. And once the requirement goes down, it should have the capability of scaling down as well. Agree? The other is innovate and lead. So the thing is that the data science world, at least for the people with whom I interact every day, they come up with a new library. They come up with KS, they come up with H5Py for writing, and the way they do things is that they every day, every week, they want to try something new. And for that, we just cannot stick to one particular cloud machine learning system. Right? Let's say stick to Google Cloud machine learning as a service. It has Python 2.7 right now and Java 1.7. I want to run an application on Python 3.x. Right? Along with that, I want to use five or six new libraries. How to do that? Right? So,
that innovation and the lead, innovation thing is the need of the hour. And it is happening every day. The other is new hardware components coming up. So,
those days are gone when we just can't think of a model without a GPU, right? It's nothing but it performs a lot of
computing very quickly, especially for your data science models, and leave GPU, right? Your hardware requirement keep on changing. Every time you can have a new component, a new processing unit, and you want to have the drivers and everything up and down, right? So this is again a need which is, and what cloud people do is, right, basically Google or for that matter Amazon does, is it gives you that infrastructure. So you can use a new version of GPU or any TensorFlow processing units and whatever comes up. We should have the capability of using them as well. And mind you, that should be pretty flexible. Whenever required, use it or drop. Otherwise, it's going to incur a lot of cost. The other is improved security and compliance. And improved security and compliance, when I say, I mean that we have data which is specific to customers and who say that my data should not go out of North American continent. Right? It processing should happen in North America. And let's say if my components are running in Asia, right? My infrastructure is deployed in Asia. That is going to be the breach. I mean, we are not adhering to the compliance what they had set up. Along with that, there will be a lot of latency. When you have your complete data in North America region, let's say, and you are trying to run it in Asia, the complete data will be copied here, processing will be done, and finally you will produce the result. That in itself requires a lot of latency. So we need to have a copy of the same application in Asia and North America in whatever regions we are serving for. Okay. And the last is effective task execution. Tasks with the growth of data, tasks are taking a lot of time, and there should be a failure mechanism. At least we should have the capability of knowing that the task has failed, even if you don't have the restart from where it left kind of a facility. But at least we should know that how sure we are about the data. Right? So these are five requirements which I feel are pretty important these days when we talk about cloud. And let's see how it goes, and we will try to resolve few of them. I will try to share my thoughts on how we had done that. So we will start with machine learning as a service, and we will try to find out what are those couple of things with what your cloud provider does behind the scenes. Okay. So this is nothing but a machine learning as a service, and it is a platform which provides all the advantages of the last slide, to be frank. Right, it provides all those. At the runtime, you can set you can set your zone, and you can just run it. You can run your job. Few famous vendors: Amazon has that, Azure has that, IBM has that, Google has that. Everybody has that, right? And the thing is that they come up with a pre-built library, right? So this, when you talk about the libraries here, Apache, MXNet, TensorFlow, Cabernet, Keras, these are the pre-built libraries which you get when you use Amazon machine learning as a service. Right, but if you use Google machine learning as a service, you will not get all of them, or maybe a subset of them, or maybe a new set of other libraries. Right, so it is important for us to find out a way to actually install those libraries as well. So our two primary area of concern here is how to use a custom infrastructure, that is, let's say a new class of GPU, and the other is how to run a job involving a non-pre-built library. Right? Any other thought which is coming in the mind that this is also a concern for us? Any other thought by anybody? No? If you have, we can share that offline, or if time permits here as well. So with this, I will start with the very first demo where I will simply try to run a simple machine learning model. And those who want to have the real feel of it, they can come and use the laptop and use the
computer. So let's talk about the two plans. One was how to install a new library, and the second was how to basically configure custom VMs for it, custom hardware for the jobs. So the thing is that whenever you file a cloud ML job, ultimately the thing is that VMs are created behind the scenes. And then these servers are actual models. Okay. So let's see. This is one of the examples which talks about it. simple machine? I have a very simple model, nothing but like MLaaS model, which has a few handwritten digits. Your models are trained on the handwritten digits, and finally a new handwritten digit comes up, and we have to predict what exactly is that. So the thing is that we are using the deep learning, the deep neural nets, as well as functions, as the activation function. But for this talk, we are not concerned about that. So we will just look into a few of the concerned in the areas which we are having concerns on. For example, if
so, this is one of my models.
This particular model uses two files which are not pre-installed. So we have.
Yeah, so this is just an MLaaS example. I'm not talking about what I'm doing in the code. But I want to highlight that I'm using a library H5.5. You see the mouse pointer and a KS which is not pre-built right now. Right? So this is not available on Google.
H5.5 and we have a KS. KS library which we are using at rest. Those who understand this is nothing. This is pretty straightforward redesign stuff which you can see. Couple of things more. So this is the way we are accepting the parameters. So whatever parameters we are passing from the main function, we are accepting it like we are accepting it here. And two parameters specifically, one is dropout one and dropout two. These are the.
So those who know a bit about data science, is dropout one and dropout two are the hyperparameters. Okay. So this is something what we during the training of the model. By training of the model, we simply mean that we want to identify a value to these parameters so that they can be used while we are doing the prediction. Okay.
And the parameters what we are optimizing for this for the model.
So we normally optimize when we talk about
the, so let's see how it happens. So the very first problem of installing KS and H5.5, for this we have to basically create a 0.5 file within the root folder of the project. And as you can see here, there is an install required constant which says KS and H5.
Right, so this install requires is the place where I'm mentioning the file names. And since I'm not mentioning any version, it is going to install the latest one.
Right, since no version is being specified, so it is installing the latest one. Similarly, for custom hardware like GPUs and all, we have a similar kind of a file, a configure YAML. And here you can see we specify the.
So standard GPU. If you go into the Google documentation on the official website, standard GPU is nothing but a class of GPUs which they are using. Right, I'm not very sure, but it is something I think 880 Tesla which they are using. We have different versions of it and they have given different names to it. Okay.
The class of GPUs should be utilized for this training. For hyperparameter tuning, I'm using a file which basically defines the characteristics of the two parameters which we talked about, that is dropout 1 and dropout 2. Let's see how we can execute this. So for executing this, I'm basically setting a few environment variables which are like self-explanatory. We have the bucket name, which is the Google Cloud bucket name. We have the job name based on the timestamp. We have the job tir, which contains.
So the reason is this. If I have
the job is going to be executed with central one and the hardware.
If I want to run it in Asia, I just need to update this value. That's it, right?
Hyperparameter tuning file which we saw. And we can submit the job on the command line something like this. So if you see this command, so our job is queued and it says something as 2017 as the timestamp. If you see the job submission, it says the job name is being taken, then the job dir is taken, job id is taken, the config file, that is the HTTP file is taken, and a couple of more files are taken, a dropout one and dropout two.
So if you can see if we have
used. The point
if you see, yeah, if you see, the thing is that we specified the HP during file while running the job, but we have not specified anything related to setup.py or the config.py. Right, setup.py was the one which talked about the new libraries, and config.yaml basically was the file which talked about the new class of infrastructure which you wanted to use, the GPUs which you wanted to use. The thing is that when we put those two files in the root directory of the project, the thing is that the moment your model starts running, behind the scenes it creates a VM only, right? And when that VM is coming up, it installs those two things. Right? Along with that, when your VM is coming up, it says that these are a couple of GPU standards which is available for your VM.
which you can utilize for training your model. Right?
So ultimately, the thing is that there are two things which we want to resolve here. One is, so there is these two are the concerns. If we can resolve those two things, and if we can come up with a generic infrastructure which simply where we can use these, we can take care of these two parameters, I think we are done, and we will see how we do that. Okay. So this is something what we saw. Now, just a quote. So Kevin Novak, who is a data scientist and a data science platform at the head of Uber, he came up with an article in April 2016, and in that article, there is a special line written which says that we will need special features, right? Because a data scientist, there is absolutely no foundation to what they think about what they want to do. So we need special features. We need to have more control, okay? We have got great engineers who can do that, okay? And with this same philosophy, we are going to look into the generic infrastructure requirements which I was talking about. So as a generic infrastructure requirement, the very first thing is how to support an altogether different flavor of data science as well as a non-data science job. If you have an infrastructure, we just cannot say that it is specific for running your data models, like data models. No. What about maybe web application, right? That is also a computer, basically a task which is running on a computer. So those should also be taken care of. Similarly, constructing a numpy, an input to your models, right? So Python is the main language for which you do it. If you utilize data science, and numpy can be an input format for it. Running the Spark job for transformations. This is a bit kind of, people don't agree with that, but I really feel that when you start a Spark cluster, you are actually wasting a lot of resources. And why you are doing that, we can discuss that if we have time in the class. And there is a big disadvantage when you spin up a Spark cluster as it is. Or for that matter, we want to have any new hypothetical task on any new technology. Okay. The other is how to work with different versions of language. As I said, Google supports by default 2.7, Python 2.7, you want to use 3.x. The other can be how to have an auto scale up and auto scale down. Because if your cluster let's say scales from 2 to 100 nodes, it should come down to 2 if the rest of the 98 are not required. Right? Otherwise you are actually incurring a lot of cost. And this should happen automatically. How to have a cloud vendor independent deployment of your DS? Right? So we have different clients who use different kind of cloud vendors. You use Amazon, you use Google. We don't want to stick to a machine learning as a service for a particular cloud vendor. We want to come up with an infrastructure which can, with bare minimum changes, that can be able to just pick it up and move to any other vendor. Right? So let's start with the very naive way of how a data scientist does. Right? You spawn a VM, you install the libraries. It's as simple as that. Right? You create a normal VM, an Ubuntu VM. You install all the libraries what you want. You want Python 3.something, you install that and use it. Right? This can be a resolution to your infrastructure bottleneck. Right? So you are using a laptop, you have 4 GB of RAM. If you need 16, you can go ahead and do it. Right? You create a VM of 16 GB RAM and do it. What you can do is you can create an image out of it. So when your machine is running, you create an image and you reuse it. Right? That's it. Till here, the data scientist can do it. But after that, it's a bit difficult for them. And this is our infrastructure, what we had done. So we have an admin module. This admin module is a module where a data scientist logs in and he places a request for running a job. Okay. It has a UI. So what we can do is we can submit a Python job, we can submit an R job, we can submit a Java job. I have a pop-up scenario here which simply takes that. Take that and create that into JSON and finally put that into a Java topic. Right? It's not a proper topic, and it's just a few. So if I have 5 blocks, 5 Java jobs, it's going to be 23 times. And there's absolutely no relation to the relationship. And what happens is, I have a consumer who actually fires it on a Kubernetes cluster. So you can use POPs or you can use GK. GK is Google Container Engine.
you will create the container. So let's say if I have a Java job, I will create a container, a Docker container, and I will use Kubernetes for managing that container. Okay. Whatever Docker images you are creating, you put that into the Docker images
as in when you talk about a production production environment, your Docker images are very specific to your project. It cannot be a public Docker image which you are using. You will be doing a lot of customization, installation, pulling of the repo and all. So in that case, it's advisable to use the container registries what we have. And finally, we have a DB which actually stores the information at the various levels. So let's say something fails here, this update of completion of the job will not come. And the thread is there which actually puts that again, right? So if you talk about a data science job, a job executed, if it failed in between, Kubernetes has a built-in way of actually rerunning the whole container. But even if that fails, we again submit that. Okay, let's see how we do this. So for this, I have another demo just to for you guys just to realize what I'm doing here is Google does not support R. Again, the statistical language. I'm not doing anything, I'm just printing a couple of statements in R script. But I want to run these scripts into different containers. Right? I have the container requirements, I'm running it into different containers, and I want to have the feature of auto scaling and scaling up and auto scaling down out of the box.
Hi guys, welcome to demo 2. So in this demo we are actually going to deploy R jobs on Kubernetes cluster, and we are not going to deploy just one, we are going to deploy
multiple
jobs. Also we are going to look into what all we need to do for executing those R jobs, what are the steps. So let's so if you see I have a cluster right now, and I'm going to use Kubernetes, which has a cluster size of 2 right now. You can see. Right, so I'm going to copy the connection string.
So I'm connecting this cluster to my VM, which
I'm going to paste it here. So the number of pods which are running. So here you can my pods.
So if you see, I have two web applications running. One is Golang, one in Python, and I have another kind of pod running, which is like a manager pod which is running for the Kubernetes cluster, and with this I want to run another data science model. Okay.
The containers. So as you can see here, I have a lot of containers running right now on this particular Kubernetes cluster. We have a hello web application which is nothing but a web application with Golang application. Similarly, we have a multi-tier Python application which is the bookshelf which interacts with our DBMS. And so we have a job completion, completed job deletion pod as well. I will come to this in a couple of minutes. So what we do here is, so the thing is that we create a Docker image. So whatever installation is required, we create a Docker image for that. So I will just try to show you a Docker file.
So if you see, the very first concern was how to have a new library be installed. Right, and for every new library, we are putting an entry into Dockerfile. We are creating an image for it.
You can see here, it basically installs a lot of R libraries, like the BigQuery and all. And it contains the rest of the commands, whatever is required. So with this, what we do is we do a build. So
we are building the Docker image, pretty straightforward stuff.
What we can do is we simply give it as R,
right?
And it created. So the Docker image is created. One thing to note here is that this gcr.io GCP experiments R is a specific format feature.
Google Cloud accepts that.
And this to push this into the container registry. So the way to do this is this. So we created R. We will give this. Right, so it will.
So whatever Docker image we are pushing it into
the container. Now we will go to the container registry to see if we have an R image.
So this is Google UI. And here you can actually see that a new image will be created with the name R.
Right, so there is an R image which was created, which is created. Now, the thing is that I'm going to use the same R image, and with this I'm going to create a pod. So in UML it is a pod. Normally a job definition or pod or container definition is defined using a YAML file. And I have a very simple YAML file which is something like this, where pod.yaml, which is nothing but a job.
Yeah. So this is a definition for container, as you can see. I have the name and all attached, I have the completion and the parameter. And we already are using this particular document. This is an image that I created before the current image was created. And this is the place where I will tell the resource requirements. Right? So the other concern has been taken care of here.
As you can see, it accepts our sample one, that is the name of the job. These are the parameters regarding the completions and the parallelism. This is the place where I'm using an image. So I'm not using the current image, R, but I created before this. These are the resource requirements. So the total limit for CPU is this much. And all the subsequent requests will.
So my container will start with one CPU and this much memory. And as and when required, it will add a discrete amount of resources. That means whenever there is a requirement, it will add another one core of CPU and another 200 something of memory.
Subsequent, I mean, discrete requests are mentioned at this.
And it has a restart policy of never. That means it was
similarly in multiple pod files here. If you see the pod, pod 1 and pod 2, those are again pretty similar configuration files. And we will just go. Fire each one of them.
So similar kind of configuration. I'm just firing
four, five pods. We have fired this, right. And now the thing is that already we had 6-7 pods.
We already have six, seven initially, and that means the current state of the structure is not going to be capable enough to do that.
So we'll just wait for a couple of minutes and we can see that we're able to see that the cluster size is going to increase. See, the cluster size is now 5. So,
this was my cluster size. I mean, it scaled up automatically, and this is happening live, so you can just see that how much time it took, right? When we talk about training the DS task, we don't have a requirement like there is a request and the response should come back in 1 second. You can take half a minute, but run it properly with all the data. When the complete data is loaded, it should not be, right? So this was the cluster size increased, and you have to accept this, that this was the same cluster which has a size of 5 and it gone back to 2. So if anybody wants to have a look, he can come and we can run it again, right? So with this, we are into the last couple of 3-4 minutes of it. The thing is, as I said, when we are running a job in Asia and the data is present in North America, right? So how we take care of that is, we actually create such Kubernetes cluster in all of the regions where we have the customers. Okay? And there is something called the federated control thing. So this is the endpoint which is there. Whatever applications we are deploying here, it is going to be deployed to all of this. And when a request comes for execution, the place which is closer to me, to my region, is actually going to take care of it. So I will run an application from Asia and it will automatically move to the US West or I think, right? Because it didn't find any such things in the region Asia. I don't have that in my.
So just a very
2 minute demo here.
Welcome to the third demo, which is basically CMO Kubernetes Federation.
If you just go to the page where we have proposed the topics on Hasgeek, the slides which are there, it has instructions of all the demos which are there. So that is an updated slide which has appendix 1, appendix 2, appendix C. And while creating the Kubernetes Federation, it's nothing but running your tasks properly and making sure that everything executed properly, right? So what I did, I had just copy pasted all of the steps which I did and what worked fine. Okay. So in the demo we are not going to see this because it is more of a setup thing, but we are going to see the advantage.
We added a couple of appendices, which is the appendix A for appendix 1 demo, and B for demo 2 and C for demo 3, which is the current one. And here I had actually specified what all the things I have done to create a Kubernetes Federation. So I'm not going to repeat these steps for the time being, but I think these were the simple steps which needs to be taken. We need to make sure that everything happens properly, every command is executed properly, and we will have a Kubernetes Federation cluster up and running. So let's see. So here I have two clusters, which is east cluster 1 and west cluster and west cluster, which are running in
east 1, right?
And west 1A, and they have cluster size of 3. So we are using a load balancer, and this load balancer is doing nothing. It's basically sitting in front of these two clusters and distributing the load. So if I just
so this is my load balancer. You can see that these are my two instance groups or the Kubernetes cluster what we had.
East 1B. So the thing is that if I just hit this URL, which is the endpoint, it should react back. So you can see there is
just one endpoint, right? Behind the load balancer, everything is happening. Of course, there are a few other steps, setting up of DNS, this and that. Everything is there in the slide, and with the reason, you can go and explore that. But with this particular
Linux application deployed, and this is deployed to both different clusters. I mean, we deployed to one of on the remote balancer endpoint, and we deployed to one. And the thing is that the point note here is that neither US East 1 and neither US West 1 are the zones where we visit our zones. So the thing is that if we keep on just executing
it, doesn't have
it should show some kind of a spike, right? And the thing is that it should go to the nearest region where we want to have this. It should go to the nearest region of execution, right? So let's see how it goes. I will just go to the monitoring thing. And here you can see that from the Asia region we are firing all the
Right.
So that's pretty much it. Thank you.
So it took. That thing which we are discussing, that it will be deployed in the nearest region, and everything will be deployed to just one region since we are in Asia, right? Just to extend this, in the last slide,
when we talk about Kubernetes cluster, we can have the Kubernetes cluster on different providers, and this is known as Kubernetes. And I'm still exploring it. Maybe the next time when we meet, I will be able to show a better demo for it. But into the Kubernetes meetups and the conferences, if you go on YouTube and search, they actually talk about Kubernetes concept coming up. Of course, it is not stable because Kubernetes has not been provided from Amazon out of the box kind of thing. How well it is, I mean, how beautiful it is provided in Google, it is not provided in Amazon. You have to do tweaks and all. But people are talking about this. This is the next step. That's it. Thank you.